We're set to go here in Daytona. Here is our KFC starting grid rolling at you across the bottom of the screen. Mike Bliss, Robert Presley will bring them down to the green flag. Late June, early July, we start in daylight, we end in darkness. The sparks will fly, the full moon will be up there, and oh, wow.
Yeah, about the first 10 laps or so of this race is the most critical. I mean, as far as nail biting is concerned, you got to try to stay in there. You don't want to lose any more positions than you have to. Stay up the front, that's where it's the safest.
Saw Bobby Hamilton Jr. right there, the 25 car, qualified in 11th position. He will have to go to the rear of the field because of an engine change.
Threatening weather to the south. There's been a storm system building around the Orlando area, and it's just touched the Speedway area briefly, but these storms here in Florida, it can be pouring across the street and be dry over here, and we actually had that situation about an hour ago.
And you heard Kurt Busch talk about these guys. They had two practice sessions yesterday before qualifying. Then NASCAR impounded the cars after qualifying. The only work they could do on these cars was adjust the tape on the front end, adjust wedge, track bar, air pressure. All of their practice yesterday was in the heat of the day. Cooler air temperatures, cooler track temperatures, it'll really make the speeds of these cars go up.
But remember one thing, Larry, they did have a race here last night on the road course, and those cars traditionally will make the racetrack slicker.
And let's check with Kurt Busch.
Well, down pit side, it seemed like we had a couple radio issues early on with Casey out with the 14 car. Seems as if he can't hear his crew chief on the back straightaway side, so he can only communicate when he's on the front straightaway. Also, I heard that Kenny Wallace has a radio issue as well. Whether it's humidity in the air or just the mid-race season at the time, it's hard on radios right now.
And you know, the irony of that is Kurt's brother, Kyle, I think back at Dover, Delaware, about a month ago, had radio issues after we had the little bit of rain delay from Saturday to Monday.
Tonight, 250 miles, that's just 100 laps. This is going to go by quickly.
See right there that pit window, 45 to 50 laps. I think that's something we're going to have to keep a close watch on. As I mentioned, a 100-lap race. Some teams thinking they could go 50 laps, but remember, their qualifying was 3 laps. NASCAR would not let them top the fuel tanks off after qualifying, so that's 3 less laps of fuel that's in that fuel tank.
And one of the things about radio transmission here, any obstructions, and you got that grandstand along the back side of the pit right there, you need to get you a big antenna and run it up a pole so that you can get a good signal to your driver on the back straightaway.
A look at our Fox onboard cameras. Jamie McMurray also with us from the Hollywood Hotel. You lose that communication. Is that kind of like a lifeline?
Yeah, I'll tell you what, guys, I'm really claustrophobic, and that's the only way that I know how to describe that. When you lose that, you don't know where everybody's at, and you're just trying to get out of the way. So that is it's a very sick feeling to have in a race car.
Yeah, and particularly here, where you're going to be all over each other.
Yeah, it's not as, I mean, at any other racetrack, with the exception of here or Talladega, it's not so bad. So that's big here, though.
All right, pace car dips in. We're about 1,000 feet away from getting this show on the road.
DW, last time NASCAR Busch Series racing on FX. Reach up there, pull them belts tight one more time.
Boogity, 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 boys, let's go racing.
Now that inside line that our pole sitter Mike Bliss is bringing along, it seems to be doing the moving right now.
Yeah, Robert Presley on the outside, back about fifth overall, leading the outside line.
Yeah, Presley did not get off to a very good start, and he's losing positions left and right.
Remember, these cars qualified and then were parked. No final practice, no adjustments after qualifying.
Looks like Presley's coming back up to speed now.
He's getting a pretty good push from Martin Truex Jr. in that 8 car on the outside.
This is when, trust me, you just got to hold your breath right now for about 7 or 8 laps till things sort out a little bit.
We see them definitely already running 3 wide. This racetrack is plenty wide enough for that, but the thing about it, these cars start bouncing around, moving around. That's when someone gets into someone, and in a pack like this, has all the makings of a big one.
Yeah, that 3 wide's only half a second behind the leader, but it's back for 15th position.
Yeah, a lot of places, you know, you run a couple laps, kind of settle in. Here you run a couple laps, and it's just getting exciting.
Well, Jamie, there's that car you would have driven tonight. Moving up. Whoa.
Moving up, moving over, moving in.
Moving on.
Moving out.
Moving.
Baby is moving.
Ah, can you tell it's our last night?
Yeah.
What's going through your mind at this point?
Well, Casey, you know, I didn't want to run this race, and Casey came over to me after the first practice and said that the car was incredible. And I talked to some of the other guys, and they said that he was definitely one of the best cars. So I'm a little bit disappointed right now that I'm not in there, but he's trying to make it three wide, and I was a little bit curious of how that was going to work out, because in Cup Happy Hour, I didn't see a lot of guys try that, and when they did, they got right back in line. So I predict that once the tires get about five or six laps on, those guys are going to be too wide, and if somebody makes it three wide, that it won't last very long.
Jamie, with all the safety enhancements, the bigger headrests, how good is your peripheral vision in these cars, really?
Yeah, you know, I don't even remember racing without having big headrests anymore. And now that they added the mirror on the left side, and the way that the rearview mirrors are, I really feel like I can see out of my car well. I mean, as good as I could even if I didn't have a headrest. I think when those very first came out that there were some issues with it. But the way the headrests are now, I mean, I think you can see really good.
So, Jamie, it's DW. You wouldn't think about racing without a side view mirror, right?
You know what? No, there's no way. And I tell you, that's the same thing, kind of like losing your radio. When your spotter says he's looking, you know, like, how far up along he is. And I think that a lot of guys use the mirrors to block, and I've done that. But more than anything, I use it just so that I don't drive over somebody if my spotter doesn't tell me he's there.
Boy, back in there, the double zero just got his nose clipped. And he may have gotten in the wall.
Well, he did coming off turn two, Darrell. He was three wide and almost scraped and almost got it again. For the lead, Mike Bliss pounds back on the outside against Harvick.
Double zero has definitely been in the wall, Mike. See the whole right side of it caved in.
I'll show you what happened to Leffler.
Somebody got in and got into him here. Let's see who it was. It would appear to me to be... They're making some good time up through here. And, yeah, Robert Presley just ran him out of room.
Ran out of racetrack.
Yeah. Robert probably, that's sort of a blocking move, unfortunately.
DW, I was talking to Jamie McMurray, and he said one thing you got to kind of watch out for is we've got 30 inches more of the safer barrier up there, and a lot of guys are struggling with that. When you try to move up that little bit, you lost 30 inches of that racetrack, especially where he got in the wall at.
Three wide for fifth across the line. Mike Wallace on the bottom, Robbie Gordon in the middle, and the one of Casey Mears on the outside.
And just believe me when I tell you, being in the middle is a miserable place to be. That car is buffing it around. He tries to hold it low. He tries to jump up high. Things all over the place.
I've been watching Robbie Gordon at 55.
Clear all around. Three wide behind you.
Some help, but he just can't get it in the middle.
Nope. David Stremme moved right past that whole
pack. Good car. Your car's good. Clear all around.
And now here comes Gordon back after him on the outside. It's Kyle Busch on the bottom.
Back to that 30 inches of safer barrier. We hear that every time we put them up. You know, we heard it at Darlington. We've heard that a lot. But I asked Michael about that, my brother, and he said, look, you just run up to the wall, wherever it is, wherever it stops.
You don't have a tape measure in the car.
No, he said, you know, it's over there, and you know it, and you just run up to it.
Right with Kenny Wallace. Leffler on the inside, did not pit, stays out. Mike Bliss, Michael Waltrip, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Harvick has faded to sixth now. There's his orange car mid-screen.
Pretty impressed with that red car on the inside right there, Mike Wallace. He's moved up from 16th position all the way to fourth. He had one of the best Fords down here in February as well.
Six laps complete of 100 at Daytona.
NASCAR on FX is brought to you by KFC. Getting hungry? That's okay. You're in Chicken Capital, USA. By Aaron's. And by Johnsonville Brats.
Come out and keep on chicken, and I guarantee. Yeah, it's a drive-through pace car. Break KFC. The only car that matters is under my hood. The Dale Jr. Diet. I eat what tastes good.
New KFC Dale Jr. collectible buckets. 10 pieces of Junior's favorite fried chicken and 4 biscuits for just $9.99. Dale Jr. buckets, they're going fast.
Grab a bucket, it's race day. Here in Chicken Capital, USA.
Hey, Mike. Mickey, how do you like the windows?
Oh, DW, they look great.
These babies are spotless.
You know, you've earned the right to drive the old Aaron's Dream Machine.
Oh, man, let me go get on my suit.
He falls for that every time.
Don't fall for other stores' high prices. Aaron's has furniture, electronics, appliances, and computers at the guaranteed low price.
He loves it when I do this.
DW, start your engine.
I can't believe he got me again.
Mike Bliss, Michael Waltrip, Dale Earnhardt Jr. lead, but some of the stories, Johnny Sauter has come from 21st into the top 10, and also a man on the move, Bobby Hamilton Jr.
And remember, he started at the rear of the field because of the engine change, and he has moved up to 17th without a lot of help from behind. He's been doing it pretty much on his own.
But Larry, if you've got a good car here and the way the draft is and the aero package and everything, you can really pick them off coming forward. But there'll be a point up there when you kind of hit a wall, so to speak. You're drafting off of 40 cars, so you kind of get sucked along there for a while.
He's going to get a little help from Casey Kane there. You see Robert Presley, that blue 47, who's moved back a bit after starting up front.
Oh, we got some movement up here on the outside. Looks like Harvick's been working really, really hard to get on the outside of Michael and Dale Jr., and he did it that time. He needs some help. I think Harvick's got a really good car and really fast. He could get somebody to draft with him.
But Jamie McMurray with us. He needs some help, but he's got a fast car, Darrell says. Is that why nobody wants to help him?
Well, you know, I don't know why they're not wanting to help him. I love it when I see somebody jump up on the outside because you can get up and race and get it too wide. But for some reason, that's just the way, that's the mentality of everybody is. If the guy in front of you pulls out, it's easier just to fill the hole and pass the car that way as, you know, to get up on the outside with him. It's hard. I mean, you got to have a really good car that can make a run like that. But, you know, if I was out there, I would think that, you know, driving the 21 car would definitely be good enough to get to the front.
Yeah, well, the yellow line is your best friend, like we said there earlier. That's just like having some, that's like there's no racetrack down there. So to get up on the outside, nobody wants to give that bottom up and open the door up.
Yeah, that's your friend, most definitely. And you know, I'm watching here, and I really think that the one car that Casey's driving is one of the better cars, and he can't get anybody to help him either. His car works really good on the outside, and you know, I drove that car the last couple of times here, and I don't know what those guys do, but it really is fast in the middle of the corner. It's not always good. I mean, it's always going on the straightaway too, but it doesn't lose the speed that some of the other cars do in the center of the corner. And you can pull up and get by two or three cars, but you just got to get somebody to help. So I would guess if Casey can get to where Kevin is, they will work together, I think.
All right, Kurt Busch with us as well. Kurt, as they came by you, that first pack of a dozen cars single file, the second pack double wide and losing ground. If you're in that situation, how do you get people to work with you to catch the front runners when all those folks want to do there is race one-on-one, side-by-side?
Well, I believe this is the stage in the race where you begin to see the chassis setup come forth. Whether you set your car up for the short run or long run, the tires begin to wear out, and this is when the good cars come forward. So you gain a few positions early on when they're three wide or two wide, but this is when you can start gaining time when you're single file.
Yeah, the other thing I think is Kurt and Jamie may tell you is he might be running that high line because the car is tight and it doesn't want to stay on the bottom. And so he's trying to run it up on the outside there to free it up a little bit.
Let's find out from Steve Burns.
Mike, we just heard Kevin Harvick tell Ricky Byers and his crew that right now he's just kind of, quote, messing around. He wants to see what his race car will do at different places on the racetrack. Right now, you see him running the high side.
Yeah, right now, Kevin Harvick in this 21 car, he has no help whatsoever, and he's going to go all the way to the back of this line behind possibly Kyle Busch or Jason Leffler in the 00 car because no one will move up there. Looks like Jason Leffler's trying to move up there to help him, but he can't because he's the last car in that pack.
Yeah, nobody will let Kevin in, so he's going to have to go to the back of that line and start all over again.
So Harvick drops to 12th. What about Truex, who right now runs in 7th? Matt?
Truex right behind the 32 car, Davis. Strummy now. Martin Truex is having issues. Right now you see him on the bottom, maybe a half a lane up off that yellow line. He cannot hug that line. The car is just way too free. His biggest problem, though, is when a car gets on the outside of him, he says, at that point, I am completely out of control.
Well, that's side draft. The side drafting, when you get right alongside somebody, wants to pull the car on the inside around, makes him loose, and he has no choice but to get out of the throttle.
Here comes Casey Mears with him, dropping to the bottom. Robbie Gordon in tow as they try to work past Stremme, and there's Harvick's. Reese's Chevy getting back into the picture with Kyle Busch and Jason Leffler. Mike Bliss, who for the first time is leading in a NASCAR Busch Series race at Daytona, third race that he's led all year. He's led three of the last four events in that Rockwell Chevy. Mike Bliss has led 17 of 18 laps in the Winn-Dixie 250 presented by Pepsi. Michael Waltrip holding tight to his rear bumper. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Ron Hornaday, Martin Truex single file. Casey Mears took a spot from Mike Wallace last lap, moves up to sixth. How about those DEI teammates, Jamie?
Well, Michael's lagging back trying to get a run on Mike Bliss, but he just they can't seem to time it out right. It looks to me like when he lags back and gets a good draft off of the car in front of him, that Junior can't get close enough to give him a push. But those guys, I don't believe they'll try to go to the outside. They're going to wait for Bliss to slide up off of the bottom and then try to duck underneath him. So it kind of looks like Michael's faking him out there, you know, wanting him to think he's going to go to the outside. But Michael is really good at super speedway racing, and I don't know that he's ever passed me on the outside. He always goes to the left. So they're just going to wait for the 20 car to either get tied or get a good run on him.
But I tell you who they're waiting on also, Jamie. You see the two DEI teammates there, Michael Waltrip in the 99, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 81, Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 is one car away from joining that group.
Yeah, I watched Martin a little bit ago, though, and he is, you know, just before he said he was really loose, he looks out of control. So, and that's a terrible feeling to have at this place. No one wants to be tight. But when you can see him chasing it up the racetrack right there. When your car's loose and then somebody gets on the outside of you and one gets behind you, it does things that you don't want it to do. So I don't know that he's going to be a huge help, but I'm sure he'll go with them if they go one direction or the other.
Man on a mission, and that Marine's number 25, Bobby Hamilton Jr., now up to 13th.
Yeah, and actually the last time by, Mike, he came by an 11th. That's where he qualified. It's taken him 1/5 of the race to get back to where he qualified after going to the rear of the field with that engine change. And he's doing it without much help.
You're exactly right, Larry Mack. And the plan was that he was going to draft with the 37 of David Green. But Bobby Hamilton Jr. just radioed his crew and said, he's too slow for me. I'm going to go on and get to the front of the pack as quick as I can.
Well, he is doing it, and he is doing it in a hurry. And I tell you, another car that had to start back there with him because of an infraction in post-qualifying, Ashton Lewis Jr. in the 46 car, he has now moved up to the 15th position. So he has a good race car coming from the rear as well.
I think I would agree with Jamie, though. I like the one car. That car looks really comfortable and smooth. But Truex, again, like Jamie just pointed out, he's chasing his car all over the place.
Leaders.
Here they go, looking to the outside. They can do it if they stay together.
And Michael didn't wait for a chance on the bottom. He's taking the high line around Mike Bliss.
And bringing all those other cars with him, his two teammates, along with Casey Mears in the one car.
Bliss has one friend, Hornaday, and who might be too far back to help.
If somebody could get down there on the inside and help him, I'm telling you, he's got a strong car. They have not passed him yet.
Saw Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 81 car down the straightaway do a little bump draft on his teammate Michael Waltrip in the 99.
I am impressed with that 20 car. He got some steam. He pulls over there. Now he's doing a little side drafting. That'll keep him ahead. Pull him right back. Look at that. Pulls him right back ahead of Michael.
Jamie, watching Waltrip and Earnhardt, if this is a preview of those two tomorrow night, is that trouble for the rest of the field?
And went with the 20 car and probably come out ahead, but he stuck with Michael, and it's going to work out for him. They, you know, all three of those cars are so strong. DEI really, really has their restricted plate program together.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing. When the other teams close the gap, you just add, if you're DEI, you just add more cars.
But while these guys been doing this side by side, all of a sudden that 4 or 5 car pack has become about a 12 car pack because they've pulled back to them now.
5 Chevys, 2 Dodges, 2 Fords. And that front nine.
Now Michael's car out front looks like it's picking up a little aero push. He was coming up off of turn 4. Looked like he had the thing chasing it out. Oh, got a car in the wall off of 4. It's on fire.
Oh, boy. I don't
Stacy know. Compton.
Yeah, the 59 car and the caution is out.
And he's going to stop short of the safer barrier at the inside of the short chute. So the first caution of the night flies on lap 25.
And I'm going to tell you, David Keith in the 95 car just barely got by. He actually had to come down pit road to avoid another wreck.
Now, this is about the time you wouldn't mind seeing a caution, because this is right when the tires start to go away on your race car. 25 laps, come in, get you four more. And
take it on back to the garage. Just take it back to the garage.
And everyone pitting here, this guarantees them they can make it on one more pit stop from here.
See what happened here, Darrell.
All the signs of a right front tire went down, but right into that safer barrier.
And boy, that 95 car, like you said, he just squeaked by on the inside. But that was heavy, heavy, heavy impact.
And Compton was lucky to be running the high line when that happened. Yellow flag at Daytona. This is the NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by KFC. Pit road is open. Here's Kurt Busch.
Kyle Busch is in. He has a condition that you call aero loose and chassis loose, or aero tight, chassis loose. So they're going to put some bite in it. Down to Dick.
Michael Waltrip has already left here. He did a two-tire stop. They adjusted the chassis because he's loose. Matt.
Four-tire change for both Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Martin Truex. Both cars. Junior has to hesitate as the 56 comes in. Both the 8 and 81 are down and away. Both were free.
And Mike Bliss has got his service on pit road. Led many of the early laps here. He said his car was just a little bit tight getting into the corners. They took one turn of wedge out of the left rear.
One of the last cars off pit road was Kevin Harvick. I'm not sure if it was because he got four tires or because they had a problem on his stop.
This car's out of the box, that right rear out of the box.
That's okay, isn't it?
Yeah, the right rear can be out, yeah. But they're doing something to the front end tape. Remember, Jason Leffler got up into the wall a while ago over in turn 3 and 4. Looks like they're adding a little front end tape as well. Dick Berger.
Leffler's got all kinds of problems with that 00, the biggest of which is that the chassis just is not working. He says the car is real, real loose. He can't run the bottom, so they're trying to fix it. Two stops is the plan to try to get that chassis dialed in.
Boy, look how the right front's narrowed up, Larry. The right front tire sticking out past the fender there where he rubbed it up against the wall.
Yeah, you can see down the whole right side where he's been into the wall.
Cleaning up after the first caution of the night, Stacy Compton crashing to the outside of turn 4 after cutting a tire. One lap and we'll go green. Kevin Harvick was having a problem. He is back in, making a second stop. With a tape on the nose, Larry?
Yeah, and I mean, it'd been reported that he was getting real tight. And Steve, I think that's why he continues to make extra pit stops.
Yeah, and also, Larry Mack, he made contact with the 60 car. They ran into each other at speed on the racetrack, and there is some damage to that right front where you saw the guys putting tape on. Ricky Byers, a crew chief, describing it as where the headlight would be, and then the area just below it. His car, as you said, extremely tight, so they had to come back down on pit road and try to get that body, get it smoothed out for the aerodynamics.
At least that answers why he had got tight. He had damaged the right front fender.
Harvick and Biffle, contact?
Imagine that.
Yeah.
Hey, Kurt, how do you think your little brother's doing out there, bud?
Not bad. The general consensus on this end of pit road seems to be a loose condition. I was down with Kenny Wallace's crew. They went down three turns on their track bar, same as in the Navy pit with Casey Atwood. They were very loose as well. Kyle Busch has a loose condition, but he's aero tight. And that's what I wanted to talk about Darrell Waltrip with. Your car, he said, was aero tight but chassis loose, and they decided obviously to work on the chassis because they're not going to do a good job of fixing the aero right now.
Yeah, no, what I'd do is I'd screw the right rear spring down about three rounds and load that right rear spring up, push that corner of the car down, get that blade up in there, and that baby will come alive.
That'll fix it, but Kyle Busch had to put wedge in the car because his chassis was sliding around loose.
No, he needs to take wedge out. Trust me.
Wedge out.
Take
wedge
out.
Turn out. Yes, you said push down, but we're going to take turns out.
Yeah, down on the right rear, which will take wedge out.
Yes, and down in my right rear on my cup car means we're putting turns in. But here we go, green.
Four Chevrolets lead the Ford of Mike Wallace to the green. It's Waltrip, Bliss, Truex, and Earnhardt.
See, that Michael tells me all the time, Kurt, I'm old school, so maybe that's old school. I don't know.
Hornaday on the bottom, the restart king.
Yes, sir, and he was coming in a hurry and had a little bit of help from behind just for a second there. Now, interesting strategy with Michael Waltrip in the 99. He was leading the race, but that team, Jerry Baxter, they elected to change just two right-side tires with everyone else changing four for the most part.
Ron Hornaday, the deuce, he'll get you a spot on those restarts. Matt?
Under the caution, Dale Jr. and Martin Truex talked about trying to make a move on the 20th Bliss. He said, let's make our move when we come off turn two. Let's go to the outside and get back in line behind the 99.
Made his move.
I don't think that 8 car, though, is wanting anybody around it. I don't think he wants anybody stuffed up behind him, because he looks like he's just hanging on to that thing barely.
Ago we were talking, Jamie, that Martin Truex's car just don't look like it's driving very good whatsoever.
No, and you know, that's the thing that, I mean, Dale Jr. and Michael Waltrip are really good at drafters, but their cars always seem to handle well here. And I heard Jr. say that his cup car was really loose in our happy hour, and almost everybody I talked to was tight. So those guys have something figured out these places to get their cars freed up and make them really fast.
I tell you, team, I'm impressed with Mike Wallace in this four car. If there's a team in the garage area that needs a good run, I think they only have one top 10 finish this year. I mean, he is up there bidding for the lead with this group.
And there he is, number 4 on that hit parade of biggest movers.
And ran well, as I mentioned a while ago, ran very good here in February with this very car.
Mike Bliss, the pole sitter, right behind Mike Wallace, looking lower. There is no lower to go. Michael Waltrip is almost Velcroed down to that yellow line, Darrell.
That's exactly where I'd stay, too, buddy. If you want around me, you go on the outside.
You see right there, Martin Truex Jr. in 8 car, he could not keep his car down and get a lot of help from Robbie Gordon. Now, on the back straightaway, it comes together. That outside line seems to be moving now. They're even getting help from David Streaming in the 32 car back there.
Now, see, there's Jr. He jumped up the outside to try to take advantage of Robbie Gordon. Let's see who comes out on top here.
Almost like Robbie Gordon, he may see that Martin Truex is very loose and he won't get that close to him, or either he can't get that close to him.
I think it's sometimes a car will not suck up to the car in front of you, particularly with that fin on top of it. Sometimes your car, it takes the air away from your air box and the engine just won't pull up.
Now Mike Wallace is losing that draft just a little bit, and he's losing the tape off his grill, sitting there flapping in the breeze. That can't be helping.
Oh no.
It really hurts the drag of the car. More air go into the radiator.
Let's go to Mike Wallace's pit, Dick Bergman.
With his crew chief, Tony Lambert. Are you as surprised as we are to see this car running as well as it is?
No, this car, we led with it in Talladega. I think we're trying to get up here and where we can get the lead. I mean, we'd like to lead this thing and say we led here. Hopefully we can go to the end and win. But you know how this place is. See, this black man, we lost two spots.
Tape flopping around on the nose of the car. How does that affect it?
Yeah, I can't see it from here. I have to get binoculars and look, but if it's the bottom, it won't hurt us that bad. If it's the top, it might hurt just a little bit.
Okay, good luck today.
Well, it's the top. It's the upper grill. That's where that tape's moving around.
And what makes Michael and Dale Jr. work so good together is that Dale Jr. knows exactly when to bump draft. You can't do that just any old place around this racetrack. And Junior knows when to give Michael that little shot to push him ahead without wrecking him.
Right now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 81 car, he moves to the high side, getting help from the car that he owns, Martin Truex, in the 8. He's going to lead this lap. And these fans, every one of them, are standing on their feet.
And it's amazing, isn't it, Larry? Michael's sitting there comfortably leading the race.
Yep.
And now look at him.
Comfortably third.
He's in a hornet's nest.
And about to be fourth. Jamie McMurray's got to leave us. I want to thank you for joining us and just wonder if there's anything you've seen in these first 34 laps that you've made a specific mental note of to remember tomorrow night when we go 400 miles here.
Well, I just am shocked at how loose all of the cars are. We fought tight the whole happy hour, and it looks like everyone's fighting loose. And I don't know if that's the aero package or just the racetrack freeing up. So be curious to go back and talk to Donnie and see what his thoughts are on that.
And Jamie, from the Super 8 Hollywood Hotel, thanks for coming out and watching with us. So tomorrow, handicap the field for us a little bit. We see what Junior and Michael are doing here.
Yeah, I mean, you know that Junior and Michael are going to be the two cars to beat. I mean, without a doubt, you look at the history of DEI here, and every single time those guys seem to be fast. So just have to hope that, you know, in the 500, the field really spread out. It wasn't like Talladega where everyone was bunched up. So a good handling race car is going to be just critical tomorrow. So hopefully we can get the Havilland Dodge to handle the way we need it to.
And it seems to me right now, guys, watching these after this last pit stop, some of these guys have gotten definitely better. Pack is definitely back together and really going three wide here.
Kyle Busch goes around Mike Wallace, so things are getting pretty wild, but thanks a lot for coming by, Jim.
Starting 32nd tomorrow, good luck working your way through the pack, all right?
Yeah, thanks for having me on, guys.
Always fun to have you with us. And actually, Jeff Hammond, who do you think did better? We, you know, Kurt Busch, the reporter, or Kyle Busch, the driver so far tonight?
I'm going to go with Kyle Busch.
All right, I'll go with Jamie McCurry from the Hollywood Hotel. Let's go back upstairs.
Thanks, Chris. You saw Mike Wallace backing up a bit. He's now slid back out of that lead pack, having just had a little bit of difficulty hanging with.
Yeah,
he's back to 17th now.
A couple of things. I still believe that race he had here last night, the road course race, has slickened the racetrack up some. They throw down a lot of oil and a lot of rubber on the racetrack that wasn't there yesterday. So I think that's part of the problem. And I think that's why the cars are a little looser.
But now just remember, Kevin Harvick in that 21 car, we saw him just a second ago. He's up to 19th, even gained some more position this lap. He restarted this race after that last caution, back in about 35th after they made repairs to that right front fender. And I think in his pits, they're still making pieces, anticipating that the car is still not completely right.
Well, it's pretty good. I mean, it's coming back to
the front. I don't
know
if I do many repairs.
Might be a problem for Mike Bliss, who started up front.
Yeah, he's back. Something's wrong with his car.
Steve.
Mike, I was just listening to Mike Bliss, and he said that he is wicked, wicked loose. Remember, before the pit stop, he said that he was just a little bit tight. Now, wicked loose.
Wow, wicked loose on the top and bottom.
Wow.
And that's how sensitive these cars are with this aero package.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., our leader. On the Winn-Dixie 250, presented by Pepsi. Welcome back to Daytona, the NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by KFC. Dale Earnhardt Jr. at 41 laps. He's led 9 of them. Mike Bliss led 22 circuits. Time for KFC trivia.
Oh, boy.
Not who is only the second person ever to have his picture on a bucket of KFC. That would be Dale Jr. But how many drivers have won here from the pole as Bobby Hamilton Jr. goes for the lead?
Up on the outside.
Jr.
That outside looks mighty enticing. The answer to that question is
several.
I would bet it's
okay, two.
Two. I would have thought it was a lot more than that.
Yeah, and just in recent years.
Man, I can't, I don't know.
Junior did it in 2003, and Nemechek did it in 2002, both in the February race.
Oh, well, that's not fair. I'm thinking this race.
Well, we got trouble.
Holy cow.
That is Jimmy Kitchens.
Oh, man.
Hard into the barrier.
Caution is out.
Back straight away. Field freezes when the caution flag waves.
All right, guys, we're done.
Second caution of the night. Comes at lap 43 for Jimmy Kitchens.
Gotta believe the way that thing came out of that.
Sorry about that, guys. We got turned from behind. Y'all had a hell of a race car. We did a good job. It's a shame, but damn.
That's Maryland, as in University of, on the side of that car.
I was gonna say, the way that thing came out of that pack, it's probably a pretty good sign. He got a tap from somebody.
And that was his radio with him talking, so we certainly know he's okay.
When you exit these corners, if you're up in a, you know, wherever you are, and you got to squeeze out the throttle ever so slightly, and the guy behind you is running wide open, he sometimes you just can't avoid the guy in front of you.
But this is what's good right here. You see how quick the safety workers, the wrecker, everybody is to this car. That's a product of freezing the field and slowing them down immediately when the caution is displayed.
Yeah, we're around. That's the first time back by the accident. And even before that, the safety workers. Let's just see what happened. Up in the pack right there. Couldn't see who made the contact.
That's pretty hard hit head on in the left front. Even though that is safer barrier back there, it's still a hard hit.
Yeah, Daytona, they've installed it around most of the inside of the racetrack as well as in the tri-oval and the outside of the corners here. You see it right there.
$2.5 million worth of safer barriers put up around this place. And it was a really good investment.
There's Jimmy walking to the ambulance under his own power. just a little touch of a limp, wave to the crowd, he's okay.
Now this is where it'll be interesting. It's only been 16 laps since these cars were to pit road. I anticipate that they will be coming, but I think we'll see a lot of just right side changes here. How about it, Kurt Busch?
Haven't quite got a confirmation yet from Lance McGrew, but Kyle's handling condition is loose in, tight in the center after that last adjustment. So we'll see what this Five Lows team has and see if they can get some more track position on this pit stop.
Looks like all 38 lead lap cars are to pit road. Most of them could not make it from here, though, without stopping one more time, because we've got 56 laps to go.
That'd be a stretch, wouldn't it?
Ronnie Gordon is going to take four tires on his automobile. The car is just a little bit tight. Tires are the only adjustment. Steve?
No adjustment for Bobby Hamilton Jr., Dick. Hamilton's saying his car is just a little free when they're right behind me. No adjustments. Matt?
The 8 and 81, no tires. Both cars took gas only, no adjustment.
Saw a lot of fuel-only stops on this round.
It looked like Ron Hornaday in a two-car. He took just right sides. But you know what? 16 laps since you just took four tires, if your car's driving good, I don't disagree with that right there. I think gas and go is a good move. Now, remember, these cars do have 22-gallon fuel cells, unlike the Cup cars tomorrow night that will only have 13.5 gallons.
And they only have X amount of tires, three sets of tires, so you can't use them all up now.
Second caution of the night in Daytona.
Here on FX, it's been all Chevys tonight. Five different leaders. Michael Waltrip passing the pole sitter. Mike Bliss, who had led 22 laps, and some problems Jeff Hammond on the speedway when Stacy Compton met up with the ball.
Yeah, he loses the right front tire. It's hard in that safer barrier. End of the night for Stacy Compton, but thank goodness for the safer barriers. You see the 59 car taken to the garage.
Kevin Harvick having some problems, had to go into the pits.
Yeah, he got together, I believe, with Greg Biffle on the racetrack, but the team decided to come in and make repairs to the front of that 21 car, and he's back up there dicing for the lead.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 81 car dominating at Daytona, leading for the second time. And the fans that are here in anticipation of what they might see tomorrow night on Fox up and hollering, and then moments ago bringing out a caution. Jimmy Kitchens with some problems, although he was okay after this. Smoking, spinning. Yeah, that's Kitchens, as in if you can't stand the heat, get out of the. And he is all right, surviving from that, bringing out the caution as we from our Super 8 Hollywood Hotel with Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers, some pit stops. How about the strategy? No tires, maybe a couple of tires?
It's kind of interesting how this is kind of playing out. We got Martin Truax and Dale Earnhardt Jr. decided to just come in and get some gas. They're back up front. Guys like Ron Hornaday and a lot of other teams putting on four tires and working on a race car. So I might be interested to see exactly how strong these two cars are now that they're hooked up.
Kurt Busch showing his loyalty with Ford earlier, but Chevy again dominating, and they own the top three spots, and they've led all the way tonight.
Well, so far it's been kind of like a bow tie brigade, as you might say. Everybody's been working together. It's going to be tough to outrun these guys if you're not careful.
All right, let's go back upstairs. DW, Larry, Mike.
Getting set for the restart. Stacker 2 track back. Chevy's won 15 of the last 18 Busch Series races at Daytona. Five in a row for Dale Earnhardt Sr., and Dale Jr. going for his fourth in a row tonight. Martin Truex Jr. will be our leader on the restart. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Ron Hornaday, David Stremme, Ashton Lewis up into the top five. Robbie Gordon, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Greg Biffle, Kyle Busch, Kenny Wallace.
You know what? We're almost halfway. It's Friday night. Under the lights, let's crank it up.
Thank you.
is this pack. Casey Mears is just 1 second from the leader. He is 13th place.
See Robbie Gordon, the 55 car, trying to get a little bit of help from Bobby Hamilton Jr. in that 25 car, trying to get up there. Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 81 shuts the door of him off turn four.
Boy, I just, bump grafting is something I just am not a big fan of. I know it helps to push a guy ahead, and sometimes he gets out, I'm not a big fan of bump drafting. How about you, Kurt?
Tip four, Pam. I saw the way that the draft is going on out there, and we're behind the scenes checking everything out with all the crews down here, and it's just kind of normal business. The way that you have to race at a restrictor plate ready is to help the guy in front of you, make sure that you don't leave a wingman behind that's trying to help you out. But the main thing is just to continue in your lane and make sure that you keep track of your tires so that you know what to change on the car.
But, Kurt, bump drafting, is that helping or can it be hurting?
It can go either way. But you want to be on the bottom side of the racetrack to keep your car in a safer position. And the middle is not all that great sometimes. And when you're on the top side, you're more on the offensive side trying to gain position.
Robbie Gordon wants the lead on the outside, the hard way.
I mean, this is what I love about this package. We're halfway lap 50, and look at this pack of cars, two by two by two, all the way back to about 25th.
And we had this on the Cup cars in 2001, and that was the most exciting Daytona 500 I think I'd ever seen. We had more lead changes in that race than we'd had in the 10 previous races put together.
Who had an ill-handling car prior to the first pit stop now appears able to hold everybody off.
Watching Bobby Hamilton Jr. in the 25 and Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 81 all the way down the backstretch, they kept going at each other back and forth.
I think what Martin figured out, Mike, is that out front his car felt really, really good. Because once he got out front, he's been able to ride there pretty comfortably.
Kevin Harvick is the man in the middle, right in the middle of that pack, in the middle lane. Now he's got a little help from Casey Mears there. That's a thick middle in that bunch.
Yeah, I mean, just remember, less than 25 laps ago, he was on pit road getting repairs to that race car, restarted back about 35th, and here he's up there in the lead pack.
And the high line is really good off turn two. Guys get a really big shot off
like,
over there.
Big shot like that.
That's a shot.
Like I say, that's real effective until it doesn't work. And the guy in front better know that that's coming. He better kind of anticipate it anyway.
Right now, Kevin Harvick in the 21, a lot like his teammate Robbie Gordon in the 55, has been a lot of the race stuck in the middle with not a lot of help from behind. What do you call it, DW? The sucker hole.
Yeah, the sucker hole. And we're starting to see the eye of the storm develop, too.
And not the storm in Orlando.
DW, look at that blue car behind Kevin Harvick. That's your old buddy Jeff Spraker in that 56 car. He started dead last on this field.
And wasn't in the race. But when the 46 got his time disallowed, that puts Spraker in the race.
And that's what we said at the top of the show. 43 drivers start, and there's not one of them who doesn't think they can win it or be competitive. The draft is so effective here.
Yeah, I'm pretty impressed with my old buddy Spraker. Good guy. Holding a pretty wheel tonight.
Just past halfway at Daytona.
They're still wrecking. Look at that.
A big pileup in turn two, and it happened well off the lead in about the third pack of cars. As they ran three wide and got closer and closer, something finally gave. Casey Atwood's in it. Justin Lavani's in it. Up against the wall, that looks like Justin Ashburn. Ashton Lewis was there. Gus Wasson and the 79 of Keith Mert, who had just gotten the free pass on the last caution. And Johnny Sauter as well.
You know, the interesting thing about that was some of the cars actually wrecked after the wreck already had happened. Here comes some cars that didn't get slowed down quick enough. See if we can see what happened back in here. I think I see a blue car going to hit a green one. Yep.
Oh, that's Fedewa going sideways.
Yeah.
I believe that was Jeff Spraker in the 56. We just had talked about him, gets into the back of him. DW, this is the trouble spot of this racetrack off turn two. Always is.
Yeah, it is.
Well, Fedewa was lucky to get away because the big pileup's out in the middle of the racetrack.
The whole thing about it is, there, you think back to Casey Kane in cup practice. There's a big dip right down there in the middle of one and two. And when you hit that dip, it upsets the car, and you never quite catch up with it. And sometimes you just get out of control off two.
Not sure who that is, but he manages to drive right through it all without getting hit. All right, watch the bright green car of Fedowa right there, on the right of your screen.
Here comes Spraker. Yeah, that's Spraker underneath of him, and he just pushes up into him. There's Ashton Lewis and the rest of the crowd.
Fedowa drives away.
Lucky man.
But when Ashton Lewis drove to the right to miss it, actually he got into it, things stacked up behind him, and you see they're still wrecking back there.
And DW, we see that a lot. The car wants to move up the racetrack right there.
Yeah, the driver just, it sucks the air off the nose, and the front of the car takes off, and you can't do anything about it except either hit the wall or the guy beside you. It's a really tough spot right on this racetrack.
There's the rest of it unfolding.
That's why a lot of guys like to run off that corner real high. So you get up high there, you get a little bit better angle. Get down low, it just seems like the car wants to pick up a great big push. And it takes off, and when it does, you can't do anything about it.
Riding with Kenny Wallace right here, this is what it looked like out of his rear bumper back at this wreck.
Well, let's look at it from up above and see how all this unfolds. There's the green car left of your screen. There's the initial contact. Now watch that white car go to the outside, and that's where the log jam is, right there.
Larry, there's a couple of, as you come off turn two over, there's a couple of dips, and in the front of the car starts bouncing, and into the car on the outside it goes.
The car I wondered about that drove through the grass and drove away was Derek Coyne. Casey Atwood was up against the wall in that. Kurt?
Well, we just watched Casey Atwood's crew go to work on the car, and it seems like, I don't know if he beat them off pit road or not, but they had severe left side damage, and they did not beat the pace car down pit road. And so what they've got to do is come back in and work on the car. But what led to that is that they came in and topped off, and thinking that they can make it the rest of the way on fuel, that put them in a bad position on the racetrack.
You're exactly right, Kurt. Hit Mike Bliss, Casey Atwood, and Jason Leffler. But the biggest thing I see, Kurt, he did not beat the stop sign, but that lip on that spoiler has come loose, and NASCAR will not let him run without that 90-degree lip on that spoiler that's mandatory.
You're exactly right, Larry Mack. They need to get some rivets put together and put it back on the car, but maybe take a hammer to it so it's not quite at the 70-degree rule.
We're going to be a little while cleaning this one up. It's the third caution of the night in the Winn-Dixie 250 presented by Pepsi. Jimmy Kitchens, who brought out the last caution, has been treated and released at the care center. Third caution of the night of the NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by KFC. NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by KFC. Thanks for being back with us. We're under our third caution, counting at least 11 cars involved in that mishap on lap 54. Martin Truex Jr. is still your leader. He came in as the Busch Series champion by 28 points over Kyle Busch, Dale Earnhardt Jr. running second, and Robbie Gordon in a Chevrolet running third. Jeff Hammond, guys pulling into the pits.
Yeah, we see Johnny Sauter right there in the 27 car. He's getting repairs done to him, and I believe it's also the 46 car of Ashton Lewis right now. He's getting some work done, and we see a lot of cars coming down pit road trying to top off, Chris, so they can make it to the finish and be in contention maybe to make a move toward the end on these guys that are leading the race right now.
So they won't need to stop again.
Shouldn't need to stop again. We just saw Bobby Hamilton driving out of the picture there. He's been good all day coming to the back of the pack. See Mike Bliss. Looked like Ron Hornaday also. So we've got a lot of guys coming to pit road to top off.
Let's check in with Steve Burns on Bobby Hamilton Jr.
No tires for Bobby Hamilton Jr., Chris. They made a track bar adjustment because Bobby said his car had gotten very loose when traffic is right behind him. They didn't want to burn their last set of tires. Now they should be able to go to the end on gas because they also topped off. Kurt Busch.
Well, Justin Labonte's in for just some repairs on the right front. He had a decent run going. It just got caught up in that. A bad break for Justin Labonte as Casey Atwood again pulls away from pit road with doing normal repairs on the left side.
All right, thanks, Kurt and Steve. Jeff, recapping real quick the incident, what started the 11 car mess?
It looked to me like Jeff Spraker came up and clipped the 12 car, Tim Fedowa, sending him around.
right off of turn two. Tim Fiedel was very fortunate. You notice the blue car,
and the 12 car
coming up and touching the lime green car of Tim Fiedel across the nose of all these other cars, and basically the big one.
43 laps to go. A big one involving 11, or at least a strung out one. Part of what we might see tomorrow when we go 400 miles on Fox. We'll be back on FX.
Stolen cars, $20 million, one cop. The smash hit driving franchise that started it all is back, Full Throttle. Critics agree, Driver 3 is the best looking game in the genre. There's so much greatness around every corner. Driver 3 will always be the king of car chase games. Driver 3, available now, rated M for mature.
Getting ready for the restart with 40 laps to go. Teammates Truex and Earnhardt lead the field. Quickly, here's Matt.
Mike, concerning fuel on both the 8 and the 81. The 8 is good to go on fuel. And I talked to Tony Urey Jr., who's calling the race for Dale Jr. He says Truex is getting better fuel mileage than we are, and we are good to go the distance. Dick?
Michael Waltrip, Mike Wallace, David Green are all going to go to the end of this race if they can. Robbie Gordon, not sure if he can make it, but they are going to try. Hornaday came in. He took his last full set. He went from third to 17th. He is now good to go for sure.
Pace cars in, getting set for the restart. 40 laps to go.
Yeah, basically the top 13 cars that's out there right now stayed out and elected not to pit. Most of those cars were on pit road with 56 laps to go. I'm sure they're hoping these cautions buy them enough laps to get to the end without stopping.
No free pass on this restart as the eligible car to move around had gone to the garage. The black flag was out for the 44, Justin Labonte.
Goes Kevin Harvick in the 21 car, pulling to the outside, but no one behind him to help him. Remember, he was 35th about 30 laps ago with damage.
Pops out in front of him. Harvick has run four Busch Series races here and never finished worse than fifth. Kurt Busch.
The last report on pit road is that Kenny Wallace can make it on fuel as well as Kyle Busch. The concern in Kyle Busch's pit, though, is will the tires make it to the end because of these big fuel cells? Back up to you guys.
Guys, Dale Earnhardt Jr. had Martin Truex sideways over in turn four. That's his race car. I don't like that bump draft in the corners.
Somebody gonna bump draft me. I just assumed it'd be down the straightaway and not in the middle of a corner.
He had the rear wheels of that car picked up off the ground.
The purpose of the bump draft is the lead car is going as fast as it can. The second car is in the slipstream, has a little reserve power, can give you a bump to help propel you down the straightaway. But in the corners?
Yeah, and you usually do that to push a guy by somebody, not when the guy's already leading the race. But knowing Junior the way I do, I mean, you know, he's probably telling Martin, hey, man, get up on the wheel. Watch it. Just, you got to see this. Here he comes. Here he comes. Watch that 8 car jump up in the air right there. Ooh. Look at Junior's flap on his cowl there popping open.
Because it changes the pressure. This has a better view of it right here. You'll see it.
Oh, yeah. Wobble, wobble, wiggle. Now, they can talk to each other, Dale Jr. and Martin Truex.
Oh, and they do.
And I'm pretty sure Martin was saying, hey, boss, what was that all about?
I'm sure he was talking to him whether he could hear him or not.
That's right. It's kind of got a Talladega Busch race look to it.
Does now.
Whoa, baby.
Oh, David Keith in the middle. 95.
This pack of cars here, led by Ron Hornaday in the two, this is part of the first of the group that came to pit road for tires and fuel.
Boy, Scrimmy, he went off the racetrack just a tad and bottomed the car out, but he was able to hang on to it.
Boy, Bobby Hamilton Jr. in the 25, he had to get out of the throttle. He almost looks like he may even have a problem.
Watch that 25. Scrimmy?
Yeah, Scrimmy got down on the apron, bottomed out, and he has a problem, all right, the 25 doesn't. I'd say he's got a left rear down.
Steve?
Yeah, Mike, DW, actually, they think it's the left front tire on that 25, left front.
Whoa, that's a car all the way down in the grass.
Presley, the outside pole sitter. This is okay.
What was he doing down there?
Oh. There you see Bobby Hamilton Jr. See, the tire has come off his race car. Caution is out.
Goodness gracious.
All right, everybody, slow down, calm down.
Take a deep breath.
Throttle.
Take a deep breath.
Now, the thing about it, the field is frozen. Bobby Hamilton Jr., this is a 2.5-mile racetrack. You have the inner liner, the tire within the tire. It looks like he will make it to pit road, still stay on the lead lap, so he should be okay. You're going to see it come off right here on the backstretch. He had already slowed down. I think he had planned on coming to pit road, and the whole tread of the left rear comes off.
Now, that was just contact between he and who was that white car that got into the side of him?
95.
David Keith.
Yeah,
Keith was stuck in the middle. He couldn't help it.
Now, how does NASCAR freeze the field? They have scoring loops, electronic lines across the track in as many as 14 places. And the cars are scored as of the last loop that they passed. When the caution flag comes out, the computer aligns the field, spits out a lineup, and that is it. It is not subject to debate who was alongside or past who. It is what it says, and they'll realign the field. Now, of course, this will change with pit stops, as a number of the leaders did not come in and top off on that last caution flag. Now, let's see what happened to Robert Presley.
Yeah, he's
when
done.
We saw him down on the bottom of the
race. All the way down in the grass. I never did know why.
The Clorox car.
If he comes shooting out of this pack somewhere, that might be one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there he is.
Contact. I think that was that David Keith again?
He got shoved down there. I think he, I'm going to say it's a white car.
It is David Keith, the 95 car.
It's a white car.
Oh, he's had a busy night.
He's bouncing all over the place.
Nice save by Presley. Look at that, two wheels in the grass and keep on digging.
And just remember, we've been talking about the yellow line being out of bounds, but the only way it's a penalty is if you advance your position. He obviously did not advance his position. Now we are seeing a lot of our leaders come to pit road. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Robbie Gordon, Kevin Harvick, Kenny Wallace, Kyle Busch, Casey Kane, Jason Leffler. A lot of cars that did not pit while ago, Kurt Busch.
Busch is in. They're going to take, looks like to be four tires, but they've had a car that's been ill-handling most of the day, whether it's tight or loose, and they're just trying to continue forward.
Yep. Robbie Gordon knew that he was going to have to take tires before they got too close to the end of this race, so they have chosen this yellow flag in order to do it. To that.
On his last stop, Dale Jr. had a gas and go. A lot of conversation back and forth between Tony Jr. and Dale Jr. They were going to stay out like Truex. Jr. said, you know what, my tires are just going to be too worn out. He made the call. They pitted.
I'm in. Give me four.
Yeah, and not only that, I think that's a great move. The tires are going to be the hot tip as far as who's going to win this race.
I know one tire that's not going to be a hot tip, this tire right here, whoever it belongs to, they will have to come back to pit road or start at the tail end of the longest line for a penalty, Steve Burns.
Larry, as you said, Kevin Harvick doing a great job of battling back from losing track position. They made a small air pressure adjustment, the only change on that 21 car, four tires.
And Darrell, I think with that many cars pitting together and we still have 35 laps to go, it's not going to hurt you, especially with this aero package. We've seen all these cars battle back from the rear in less than 20 laps.
Yeah, you're going to get a good draft up through there, but tires, the cars, the handle goes off on the car so badly that this is going to give the guys an advantage. It took tires, they can run wide open where the other guys won't be able to.
Well, who's got the roll away here?
Like it came from the pits of that blue car right there. I'm not exactly sure who that car is.
I think that's Jeff Spraker, who is still on the lead lap despite being involved in the caution before this. And Darrell, you said he would troll his way to the top, and Greg Biffle has done just that in that fast car.
Old Biffle, I'm telling you.
Second place.
You just give him a little bit of something to work with, he'll do the rest.
And he qualified back in 22nd. We talked to him on our qualifying show last night. Very disappointed how that car ran by itself, but I think he knew he had a good race car that would race good.
Well, he's about to show it. He is second to Martin Truex Jr. as we get
now, this is not
here.
This is not bump drafting here.
Well, in a sense.
This is like Triple A.
They are teammates, Johnny Sauter and David Green in the 37.
Well, David Green has been having engine problems on and off for the last several races in a row, including this one. He called in before that caution flag to say that the engine was missing. The crew tried to push him down pit road, physically push him to get him going, but they couldn't get the car started, so his teammate, Johnny Sauter, put his front bumper, and you see his front bumper right on the back of the number 37 car, David Green, to try to get him fired up, get him going. Green still is not running. This is a serious problem for Green in contention to win the championship. He came into this event third in points.
Yeah, he's still in trouble because it's still not fired. He's still getting a push from Johnny Sauter.
Well, the engine's missing.
That battery.
Hammond will find it.
Yeah, the engine's missing. I mean, what do they expect?
And now, our Just for Men rejuvenating moment of the race, brought to you by Just for Men Hair Color. More than a hair color, it's the rejuvenator. And it's Junior winning the race off pit road, which rejuvenates his chances for victory tonight.
This bunch right here, I think, likes it. You the man.
Give me five.
And there's Dale Jr., 16th place, just ahead of Kenny Wallace.
Okay, let's bet. How long will it take him to get back to the front? What do you think?
I can name
laps.
That leader in six green flag laps.
Six green flag. You say 12. I'm going to say it's going to take him to about five to go.
That long?
Yeah.
Just when it counts.
That's right.
Let's find out. Here they come off turn four. Martin Truex Jr., who got his first Busch Series win at Bristol, is our leader. Then he won at Talladega, Gateway, and Nazareth. Green flag.
Green.
33 laps to go.
Michael Waltrip in the 99 drops to the bottom. Is he going to get any help down there?
He better get it in a hurry. He did.
You hear him going through the gearbox here. Off into turn one. Ron Hornaday in the two car pushing.
Usually don't get all the way into high gear till you get on the back straightaway.
And significantly, 11 cars have left the rest of the field.
They pulled away in a hurry.
But the old chicken car is back in there.
Cluck, cluck.
She'll be coming up through there. Stroker Ace will be coming to the front.
Casey Mears in that one car, he's going to get some help from Greg Biffle in the 60 car on the high side.
Yeah, what happened to Biffle on the restart? Went from second back to about sixth here.
Boy, I tell you, that's one of the things that can kill you is the restarts. I mean, you get the wrong gears in the transmission, and you just don't get a good start, and you lose a bunch of spots.
And look at Kevin LePage in that 71 car. He has fought his way in the lead pack, started way back in 31st, and two cars that's in there that had fallen back. Mike Wallace in the 4, and our outside pole sitter, Robert Preston, in the 47. And look at Robbie Gordon in the 55, and look who he's bringing with him, that 81 car.
Dale Jr. Second pack has caught the first. Here we go.
Are you keeping count?
Yeah.
I tell you, another car that I'm seeing in this pack right here, remember, he was involved in that wreck back on about lap 53, Tim Fita, with that green car on the bottom. He's in the lead pack.
Yeah, he got spun through it and slid out of harm's way.
That's the thing that makes this aero package so exciting, I think, and fun to watch, is you're never out of the race. You can always come back to the front. Now, the question is, can you stay there? But you can work your way back up there.
Can anybody stay there? Truex can for now. Michael having a look.
Ooh, Mikey dropped down to the inside. I think that opened the door for Truex on the outside. Truex has got a fast hot rod. I mean, he just... Yeah. Drove by on the outside, can't quite.
And Casey Mears in that car that Jamie McMurray decided not to drive tonight is right up there side by side for the lead. And Biffle's right with him. Chevy, Dodge, Ford.
I like that one car. That's a nice car.
There's that 81 car, Dale Earnhardt Jr. up there battling for fifth.
And there's that wide behind them with Kenny Wallace and Kevin Harvick in the middle.
Yeah, don't look back, boys.
It's just so hard to tell which line's going to prevail, bottom of the top.
And up to about 10th, Jason Leffler, the double zero, the car that wrecked against the wall early in the race. Didn't do a whole lot of damage. He's right back in it.
Yeah, it's just like an opera, you know? It just builds and builds and builds and all of a sudden...
They don't sing at 7,000 RPM, do they?
Oh, yeah, baby. It's a beautiful thing.
When you think about that one car, Casey Mears, you know who built the engine under the hood of that thing? Ernie Elliott.
Mm-hmm. It's all coming together.
There you go.
16 cars tightly bunched in the lead pack. Another 10, a short string behind them. 29 laps to go in Daytona. Tonight's
Tonight's race is brought to you by Smooth Busch Beer and Easy Drinking Busch Light. Busch, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
Looks like Michael's got a problem, guys.
Michael Waltrip off the pace.
It may, after what we saw in the backstretch, we're going to see it here. It may be a flat tire, possibly, DW.
See what's wrong with him here.
Right side of your screen.
They just squeezed the one car, Casey Mears, in the inside, into the outside to David Streaming in 32. There you see Michael Waltrip in the 99, all the way to the bottom of the racetrack.
Yeah, he got bumped by Kevin LePage there, but that was kind of square in the back, not enough to do any damage.
It might have been a left rear. Michael may have just thought it was a flat tire because of the contact.
Now, Strimmy, listen here. A little scrape.
Definitely got into it, though.
You know, I think Michael might have thought that he had a left rear going down.
Dick?
Yeah, that's exactly what happened. Michael did think he had a flat tire, but he just heard from his spotter that it looks like the tire is up. So there's a moment of indecision here as to what to do about car 99, Michael Waltrip.
Meanwhile, on the left of your screen, it took Dale Earnhardt Jr. from the restart exactly five laps to retake the lead. Harvick is there, and Loeffler is right up there with Harvick. Two slightly damaged cars in the hunt, and Robbie Gordon pounding along on the bottom in second.
I think once that eight car got it out front with those four fresh tires, he's only going to get stronger.
The third place point man is behind the wall. Here's Curtin.
I was down here enjoying myself during this part of the race with a Coke C2 because it's 30 laps to go, but we have David Green behind the wall. David, you have an electrical issue and the car just shut off. Exactly what do you think the problem is?
Yeah, the last restart, Kurt, the thing missed and carried on, and then it finally just shut off, so we have no power here at all. So we thought it's a battery, but the battery wasn't a problem. I don't know if it's on-off switch or here or what, but sometimes when it rains, it pours, you know how that deal goes. So.
Bummer break for David Green. Running third in points, but they will bounce back.
You know, guys, you talked about the fresh tires on Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 81. Robbie Gordon in that 55, he pitted as well with Dale Earnhardt Jr. And it's not that new tires make you faster. You just can maneuver and drive the race car.
Well, you pick up that aero push here that after about 15 or 20 laps. So they're going to be 15 or 20 laps into the run further than these other guys that didn't get tires. Don't wear out. They just give up. They just start sliding, lose grip.
Two cars trying to break away. 12 trying to track them down, and then another 10 strung out behind them. 23 laps to go. Can Dale Earnhardt Jr. win his fourth Daytona Busch race in a row? Stay tuned. Back to Daytona, the NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by KFC. Slow car entering the pits, dodgeball, as it were. Kenny Wallace limps onto pit road. Really, he's ripped up the right side of that car earlier. Yeah. David Stremme, right in front of traffic.
Yeah, Larry Hollenbach just about knocked Kenny Wallace into the pits as Kenny tried to get down.
Kim Crosby back on track after being involved in the lap 55 caution that took 11 cars off track.
But while all that was happening, look, you don't see no 81 car up there. Robbie Gordon in the 55, his teammate Kevin Harvick pushed him past 81, and 81 is all the way back to 6, but he's getting a little bit of help now from that 8 car, Martin Truex Jr.
I think that's what he kind of fell back here. He said, let me help you get back up here, my friend.
So now teammates working together 6th and 7th, teammates working together 1-2. Robbie Gordon and Kevin Harvick, who may not be the best of friends, but they are teammates at Richard Childress Racing. Robbie Gordon owns his own Busch car, but Childress provides the power, and Harvick is in a Childress piece. Show you what happened to Crosby here.
Ooh.
And there's Kenny Wallace.
That's what happened to Kenny Wallace.
The right side wiped off.
On the wall. Now, when Kenny tries to get the pit lane down here.
Ooh, wow. Pretty hard lick.
Pretty good lick.
Now, earlier, what happened to David Stremme? The 8 gets into the 1, which gets into Stremme. And right there created something that rubbed on that right rear tire and took Stremme out of contention. That was the earlier damage to Kenny Wallace. Happens right in front of Robert Presley. Stremme wrestles that car down as the tire comes apart coming off the corner.
But meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in that 81 car, he's starting to work his way back to the front. He has moved to the high side, getting the push not from his teammate, but from Casey Mears. And that one car, he's back up to third as we've got 16 laps to go this time.
To the leader's pit, Dick Bertrand.
Let's rewind to Talladega in the spring. Robbie Gordon driving this same car led 46 laps, more than anybody else in that race. But late in the race, he left the bottom open and did not wind up winning. Instead, he wound up finishing second. As soon as Gordon took the lead tonight, Bob Keppel, his crew chief, got on the radio and told him all he had to do was keep the car on the yellow line going through the corners, and the race was his. Matt.
Dick, an update on Martin Truex. He's telling his crew chief, Bono Mannion, I just cannot run on the bottom. I get way too loose. He's tried to go to the high side. He's on the outside of Ron Hornaday right now. He had a big push going by Jason Leffler, just trying to be patient with 16 to go to work his way back to the front.
Yeah, Matty, the only way that eight car is happy was when it was out front. Back in traffic, it's just a handful.
And just remember, he's got as old a tires as anyone out there in this group because he stayed out the last two times.
Yeah, but company's coming here on the outside. Junior goes way up the hill.
May have been a little bit higher than he meant to, but he gets a heck of a run off of two over there.
Without any help whatsoever, he pulls up beside Kevin Harvick in the 21. Robbie Gordon, I think he's going to do what he was told to do. He's going to hug the bottom of that racetrack. Harvick continues to fight back.
The yellow line is your best friend. Trust me.
I'm just impressed with this run by Mike Wallace. Fred Biaggi, the car owner, you won't meet a nicer guy. They weren't even going to run Milwaukee last week, had 11th place finish, up here battling in the top five. Great run for this group.
Ooh, he just sliced down across the nose of Hornaday, though.
He did.
That's a Wallace in the four. Here comes Truex, and now it's 11 cars under a blanket. 14 laps to go in the Winn-Dixie 250 presented by Pepsi at Daytona. Caution is out at Daytona in the NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by KFC. Big piece of metal debris in the back straightaway. Several drivers ran over it. As we go to yellow now with 12 laps to go, this will be what NASCAR calls a quickie yellow, meaning everybody can pit on this lap. Watch Hornaday's car on the right side of your screen.
Bam.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's up in front of him, up in the area of Mike Wallace.
Looked like it.
Oh, Harvick ran over.
Yeah, I think it came off of Harvick's car. Okay. And that's pretty serious, whatever that is.
It's aluminum, whatever it is. You know, they had run aluminum crush panels above the rear tires. They close out the rear bumper.
It's a Band-Aid, looks like it's coming loose.
That won't be good.
You know what that was, Larry? That's that piece of aluminum that they taped over that hole.
And we're seeing a bunch of our lead lap cars come to pit road. Greg Biffle, Kevin LePage, Michael Waltrip, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Jason Keller. Seeing a lot of our lead lap cars come to pit road.
They saw Dale Jr. get tires and come to the front in how many laps?
Four.
Five. Whatever.
No, it's a good call.
Here comes Stremme onto pit road. Oh, boy.
And that's how you say, would you? I'm okay. All right.
The good thing is, though, the NASCAR officials are required to wear helmets as well as all the crew
members. The other thing, look at me, there's officials everywhere. There's five of them watching him make his pit stop.
But they're like referees, right? They're part of the playing field.
Casey Atwood also on pit road. This should be the final caution, and this will be a shootout. Full moon Friday night is going to come down to nine laps to go. Robbie Gordon and Kevin Harvick, teammates, leading Dale Earnhardt Jr., Mike Wallace, Ron Hornaday, Casey Mears, Martin Truex Jr., Earnhardt's teammate, Jason Leffler, Kyle Busch, and Casey Kane. There are six Chevrolets, one Ford, and some Dodges there in that top 10.
Pretty critical restart right here. Dale Jr. kind of, if they go one way and he goes the other, he could get up front right here.
They all but run over the pace car, and here comes Gordon.
Get ready.
Junior's laying back just a little bit. He's trying to anticipate the score, but I think it it's going to pay off for him. He's going to get a run on these two guys.
Nine laps to go. Kevin Harvick, his teammate, tucked right on that rear bumper. A little bump draft on this restart.
But here comes Junior. He got back. He got a good little run on those guys.
Now he's up there in that windup lane. Harvick, is he going to be patient or is he going to go?
They just need to stay right there, and they opened up the bottom. Harvick did, and he's going to stick it. 81's going to stick it in there.
Whoa!
Uh-oh, Robbie Gordon's got a problem.
Yes, he does.
Well, that's a shame.
Clear, that's awesome.
What a tough break for Gordon. Three wide, it's Leffler again, rim riding the high side.
You know what, guys? Robbie Gordon may be out of fuel. He possibly may be out of fuel. Dick Berger, tire down is what he said. Tire down, Larry. That's a shame.
Mike Wallace getting help from Hornaday. Goes for the lead with that Ford.
And that is the guy that he wants to win. He'll do whatever it takes to get up there and win. He's on the high side. Hornaday, get up there with him, buddy.
I got a pretty good idea Hornaday will stay hooked in back at 81. Hornaday jumped out there and helped that Ford right now. That wouldn't be good politics.
And I didn't mean to come across, I'm pulling for Mike Wallace, but I pull for an underdog, and right now Mike Wallace is an underdog.
Right now the underdog is anybody but that 81. Dale Jr. going for four in a row.
I think he's got pretty much the situation he would like to have now. Got Hornaday right there.
You heard him say, seven to go.
Of course, Harvick and Hornaday, you know, they might decide to do something here, but they're going to have to be mighty good to get around Dale Jr.
It's going to take two cars to beat that one white one.
And they just can't get, you know, see how spread out they are? They're going to have to get really tight to do that.
Steve Burns.
And Mike, remember, at the top of the broadcast, we said Ron Hornaday has finished in the top 10 in four straight restrictor plate races. He felt like he could have gotten a win at several of them, but he didn't have any help. He's got it tonight in the form of Kevin Harvick. Let's see if he can take a shot at Junior.
And he just has momentum on his side. Three consecutive top five finishes last three races.
And you know what? Harvick would help Hornaday win this race. I mean, I'm pretty sure he would try to knock him around Junior if he could. Bump draft him around Junior if he could.
Six laps to go. Six car breakaway at the front. Here's Matt.
Mike, Boto Mangan and the Chance 2 guys prepare the cars running first and six. Boto, you got one guy leading, but can Truex get up there and make it another 1-2 finish?
Well, we've had a little different pit strategy than Dale Jr. We didn't take tires, and we thought just staying up front and out of that back pack would be the best for us where we are in the points, but I wish we would have took some tires now, but I think Dale Jr., he's pretty strong. Martin's been real strong, too, just a little stuck in the back there, but Dale Jr. looks good. Hopefully, we'd rather see Martin win, though.
Truex currently in the sixth position. Now, Mike, the guy who's in the fifth spot, the four car, Joey Meyer, Martin Spotter, had a funny comment. He says, the four helps, but then it's like a hair clog in a drain. He stops up, and he stops our momentum.
Well, that six-car breakaway became 3-3-3, and now it is 6-5.
I want to tell you a guy that has made a move, Michael Wallace, from his 99 car. He's up to eighth position. It took him about four laps with those fresh tires. We're riding here with him right now, and he's bringing Casey Kane with him.
And he's closing. I mean, he is closing in a hurry. He can run wide open because of the fresh tires.
He's up alongside of Truex, makes the pass. Waltrip to sixth, and with him are coming Leffler in the 00 and Biffle in the 60. All with new tires.
Boy, I tell you, tires are a big factor here this weekend, Larry. More than I think I've ever seen before.
And I don't think he's finished yet. He's got the 00 with him. As we got four laps to go this time, he's up to the sixth position.
All three of them are lined up on the outside. Add Biffle to that group. Here they come, the 99, the 00, and the 60. They've got time. They've got four laps to go. Waltrip restarted 25th. And here he is at sixth.
With tires.
And remember, Greg Biffle was another one of those cars that got four tires.
And now with friends. Oh, he is coming in a hurry. Got some pushers with him.
If they get to the front, this is going to get really interesting.
Just see how much, just look how much difference tires make. Just go around them on the outside. Kind of got that Dale Jr. look. Squeezes through.
Whoa,
right here.
Today.
And look at the help he's got, though. Jason Leffler, he was in trouble when this race started. He's pushing Michael Walker up here. Three to go this lap.
By Biffle behind me, I'd be pushing too.
Got to clear
that
Hornaday.
Car's fast.
Clear Hornaday here, which they did get a run on Dale Jr. off of turn two over here. Mikey's going to the lead.
Michael Walker. I don't think Leffler and Biffle, though, are done with him, Darrell.
I don't either. And Dale Jr. says, hey, where'd you come from?
Teammates tomorrow night, but not this evening.
And Jason Leffler, he is staying glued to that rear bumper.
Look at the hood. Look at the hood on that one car.
Clear,
got
clear.
It bowed up. Now what does Michael do?
Well, he's in clean air. The problem is there's still 2.5 laps to go.
Yeah, and of course, you know, Leffler pushed him up there. You hate to leave Leffler out to drive.
Hey, buddy, let's hang on with this thing now. Two to go right here.
Down there.
Two to go this time.
Now Biffle is right to the back of Leffler, and here they come.
Boy, Michael's loving this. He's out front. They're running side by side behind him.
It's not over.
Now Jason Leffler is up to zero. He's battling for the lead, not with a lot of help behind him. And look at Robert Presley on the 47 on the high side.
Where did he come from?
He has been coming.
That car had two wheels in the grass the last time we saw it.
Look at this wad here.
Holy smoly. Hang on to her, Mikey. I would like to tell you help's coming, but it ain't.
I mean, look at them. Two by two by three. We'll be coming to the white flag this time.
Come on, buddy. I don't know about this.
14 cars, and any one of them can win it.
Oh, it's a dead heat with one to go. Michael Waltrip on the inside. Jason Leffler on the outside. White flag.
White flag, man. White flag. Good push coming right here.
I tell you.
Uh-oh.
What? What do you see that I don't see?
Turn three is what I see. They're at turn two right now.
Boy, this is going to get... This has got...
Clear, clear, clear. Coming back, coming back.
What I see is 16.
Oh,
he's like Spunny.
Oh, man. Leffler got into the back of Mikey and Spunny.
All right, no caution yet. No caution.
Oh, man.
Leaders at three.
Here comes Dale Earnhardt Jr. He goes to the high side. Leffler's trying to block him. Look at Mike Wallace in the four.
Leffler went up, and Wallace is going to win it, or is he?
Leffler,
it's not over with yet.
Leffler put Junior in the wall.
Checkered flags in the air, no caution.
Mike Wallace.
Can you believe that?
Oh.
Now the caution is out. Which basically means any cars that had not crossed the start-finish line, they are frozen.
Look at that fist pump. Right, Jason place. Leffler battled everybody. Mike Wallace drove through the middle of it to score what is likely the biggest win of his life.
I would say so.
Darrell, it looked like Leffler was trying to do a cross under on Michael, got right to his back bumper, tried to swerve off him, and got him.
Yeah, he did. And then, of course, he got down here to turn three, and Junior tries him on the outside, and he swerves into him. So he was doing everything he could to keep people behind him.
And Mike Wallace becomes only the third. We got some unhappy people here in these pits, though.
And that is not surprising.
No, not at all. But what I was going to say, Mike Wallace becomes only the third non-Nextel Cup regular to win here at Daytona in the Busch Series since 1982.
Well, I tell you, Michael Curtis, he came from all the way 25th to the lead, leading on the last lap. Thought he had it.
But look at Mike Wallace celebrating inside that car. I'll bet he can't believe how the track just opened up in front of him.
I bet the little guy on the hood is enjoying this ride tonight. Here's
watch
Michael.
The 99.
Comes off turn two there. He's got enough room. I hear his spotter tell him, clear up. He goes up in front of Leffler. And Michael just was not straight enough when Leffler got into him. If he'd been a little further down the straightaway, I think he'd have been all right. But just enough to, Michael was still turning enough that it turned his car around.
And that slowed Leffler enough to give Junior a run on Leffler on the outside.
Then he gets down here and...
Yep.
I'm just glad that thing didn't turn over.
You get that?
that grass. That's the big recipe about it.
Safer barrier. Michael's wife, Buffy. The sport turns that quickly. Now there's Leffler. Junior's got to run because the Leffler's bumped with Michael.
And Leffler's on the bottom, and I mean, he just goes up the hill until he runs Dale Jr. into the race, into the wall.
And at that point, Darrell, he wasn't going to win it. But Mike Wallace had the whole bottom lane opened up for him and went from fifth to first on the last lap.
Both those cars hit the wall hard. There you see Mike Wallace in the four, go all the way to the bottom of the racetrack.
Junior came across the line 17th.
I mean, this is so huge for this race team. This race team has raced a lot of races without a sponsorship on that car.
It's not a miracle. It's a driver who put himself in position to win if things went his way. Mike Wallace drove a smart race. And turn three opened up for him. He's going to Gatorade Victory Lane.
Tell me what you don't like about yourself.
I was victim of female genital mutilation.
They can say.
Back at Daytona, one brother to another. It's been a long time, 138 races since his last win. Mike Wallace, brother of Rusty and Kenny. That's Kenny giving him a high five. And he was running fifth, Mike Wallace, in that last lap. Ended up winning. For Mike Wallace, that last lap must have felt like 60 minutes. He's in victory lane, and Matt Yocum is there.
Back in 2001, Mike Wallace won the inaugural Truck Series race here in Daytona. And it's just going to be the start of a huge celebration for the entire Wallace family. Wow. One lap to go. You're in fifth, Mike. Take us on that winning passes to the front.
You know, Matt, I am so happy right now. I'm not sure I can even tell you how. All I know, Fred Biaggi, I need to compose myself here a second because this is, you know, this has been a long time coming.
1994 at IRP.
It's Daytona. I've won here in the past. The first, the winning pass was just kept digging. Let me tell you what, Tony Stewart and I had a conversation today. This guy's a hell of a good guy. Heck of a good guy, excuse me.
What'd you tell him?
He just...
Trust me, this guy gave me probably some of the best advice I've ever got in my life. We've had a pretty tough week here, but I'm telling you, good things happen to good people.
Okay, enough of him, I want to talk about.
Yeah, exactly right. Good job, buddy.
Thanks, man. Fred Biaggi, Pat Biaggi, my car owners, my wife Carla, Lindsay, Chrissy. The last few laps was just intense. We got behind. I didn't know if I should go with Junior on the restart. Robbie had a flat tire. I just kept digging. I seen Jason try to run to the top to block the move. And my car just turned good. It really did. And I'm so incredibly happy. I mean, there's so many people that doubted my ability. I really, you know, this is for all the people that doubted it. But I want to thank Geico. You can save 15% on your car insurance, sports clips. You can get some haircuts, precision gear, everybody at Biaggi Brothers. I can go on and on. And I'm going to go on and on. This is my little boy, Matt. But, Matt, this is a big night for us. I mean, it's huge. It's Daytona, and there's nothing better than this place.
We've got some good news. Mike Wallace back in victory lane at Daytona.
Yes! Today.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr., far from victory lane, sits on pit road with the right side of the car bashed in. Victory was in sight. What happened?
Well, we were the double zero spun Michael out off of two, and we got a run on him, and we went up to the high side, and he fenced us and him both. But it's makes you mad, you know. Have you ever been so mad you didn't care whether you lost the fight or not? That's kind of how mad I was, but, you know, just disappointing. We had a good finish. I didn't want to wreck my car, but, you know, you go for the win, and that, you take that chance. Real happy for Mike. Great to see him and that team win. They needed a win, and just upset that we're wrecked out of the race. Guy was running. Leffler was just running too crazy there at the end. You know, I mean, I know he really wants to win real bad, but he's got to do it without making a lot of enemies first. You know, it comes back to haunt you one of these days, and it always does.
Young man behind looking for you. Steve?
And we're with the driver of that double zero, Jason Leffler. And Jason, Dale Earnhardt Jr. just said you were a little too crazy on the last lap. Let's hear your side of what happened on that last run.
Well, Michael slid up into me. I feel bad about it, but I was trying to, I got into him to get him going again. He was a little sideways, and feel bad for him and all his guys. But the guys on the Haas Automation Monte Carlo did a great job. It just gets crazy there at Talladega. Junior knocked the crap out of me with three to go. So, you know, it's just, I think that's the way, when it comes down to these last laps, that's how you got to race. And I mean, we're prepared for it. We built big bumpers and everything. But like I said, it was nothing intentional with Michael. He slid up, I think, and then I just tried to keep him going so we could pull away from the guys behind us. And he was just a little sideways, and I got into him. I didn't even really hit him. I just kind of leaned up against him, and the way he went, I just feel bad. And, you know, it's just, that's racing, hard racing.
All right, thanks, Jason. Appreciate your patience. Back upstairs.
We said at the top of the show, you can race three wide and four wide here. You can't block more than about, one and a half wide.
Yeah, you got, I mean, this kind of racing is tough racing. There's no question about that. But you got to use some common sense. And, you know, you're already taking the leader out. And you get down to turn three, and the guy goes by on the outside, and you get up into him. That's a little much.
But I tell you, I like this aero package. Yes. I wish aero package was back on the Cup cars. They had it in 2001. It just needed a little tuning, a little smaller fin, maybe a little smaller wicker on that spoiler. Good racing tonight, and new tires prevailed most of the night.
A great way for us to end the Fox half of the NASCAR Busch Series season, and good practice tonight for tomorrow night when we get to hold our breath for 400 miles. Chris?
All right, thanks. Mike Wallace, father, husband, 45-year-old, the winner in Victory Lane. And this is what it does, Jeff Hammond, to the points as we look at Martin Truex Jr. leading Kyle Busch, Greg Biffle third. How about what Leffler said, your reaction to that after hearing what Dale Earnhardt Jr. said?
I have to kind of like side this time with Dale Earnhardt Jr. I think when you get down to that place right there, he shouldn't have been slamming the door on Jr. like he did, but they both paid the price right now. But congratulations to Mike Wallace. He pretty much summed it up in one of his statements early on. Hey, it's nothing but a high-speed chess match. You've got to know where to move and when to move. And tonight, he had the right move at the right time.
Story of an underdog and Ford breaking through in a Chevy-dominated race.
All night long, we kept talking about that, those bow ties, but when it came time to get to victory lane, that blue oval of Ford guy came through when he counted.
Hey, Robbie Gordon with nine laps to go, RCR. They looked like they were in good shape with Harvick right there, and the tire went. They had a strategy that I think may come into play when we watch the Pepsi 400 tomorrow night on Fox.
You've got to team up to beat a DEI car as far as the trick plate racing. I believe RCR had the plan tonight. Kevin Harvick and Robbie Gordon were going to pull it off, but a flat tire kind of aborted that agenda. But for Mike Wallace, hey, he got a little bit of helping hand out of the Jason Leffler car to take the DEI bunch out.
Yep. We want to thank Kurt Busch for helping us as our pit reporter. Also, no more racing on FX for this year, but Fox Sports Radio Race Day. Check him out in your local market Sunday mornings from 9 a.m. to noon Eastern, hosted by Rob D'Amico, Michelle Rayall, and Artie Arani for all your racing needs, NASCAR and otherwise. As far as the rest of the weekend, tomorrow on Speed, the O'Reilly Auto Parts 250. That's at 3 Eastern. And then, of course, 7 o'clock Eastern, 4 Pacific, from right here in Daytona, the Pepsi 400. Dale Earnhardt Jr. will join us live on the pre-race show. We'll talk to take a look at some of the drivers and how they play video games. Is it work or is it play? What are our chances of seeing a long shot win tomorrow night?
I think it's really good, if you want to know the truth about it, because more fireworks, a little bit longer race tomorrow night, the same type of intensity.
Well, the day began with a chance of rain threatening in the area. They rushed up the start. It really wasn't a factor. Mike Wallace was surviving, as many did at the end, an 11-car crash. Chevys dominated the entire race. Mike Wallace running fifth into the last lap, only led one lap. It was the one that mattered. His first win in 138 races. Tomorrow night, under the lights here in Daytona, will Jeff Gordon win back-to-back races from the pole? Will Tony Stewart respond to the on-track NASCAR punishment? Tune in and find out for Stricker Plate Racing on Fox tomorrow night. Thanks for watching.